إن الحمد لله، نحمده تعالى ونستعينه ونستغفره، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الذين آمنوا. I want to start with this ayah. يا أيها الذين آمنوا. O you who believe. O you who Allah has addressed with iman. Allah mentions this phrase many times throughout the Quran. O you who believe. And when Allah mentions this, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he says, "Imma khayrun tu'maru bih wa imma sharrun tunha anhu." That listen, there's either good that you're going to be commanded with or evil that you're about to be prevented from. Listen, fastami' ilay lima fihi min al-khayr. So listen to whatever is going to come after Ya Ayyuha Alladhina Amanu. Listen carefully. And one of these surahs, a short surah, Suratul Hujurat, is a surah in which Allah mentions Ya Ayyuha Alladhina Amanu multiple times. And the ulama, the mufassireen, they sometimes refer to Suratul Hujurat as Suratul Akhlaq, the surah of values, of ideals, of manners. And many of us today, we hear this, right? In your workplace, if you take a course, they talk to you about the importance of having values, ideas, the culture. So something that we all unite upon today, something that is called something that is a global value accepted, is humanity. And this is why we have things such as human rights, right? Because humanity, we talk about humanity. So we have human rights. But we Muslims say that the best and the most authentic source, the one with the highest authority to talk about humanity and human rights and what manners are, is none other than the creator of humanity and humans, Allah the Most High. And Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَمْ. That this Quran, it guides to that which is upright. So back to what we're talking about, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. And I want to mention here this globalized value that we call of humanity. Let's look at what the Quran, as Allah mentions in this chapter, some lessons that we can learn about humanity that we can share with the world and that we have shared with the world. And we start off from the very start. Allah says in the Quran, in the start of Surah Al-Hujurat, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. That, O you who believe, do not precede Allah and His Messenger in any matter. What do we mean by this? التقدم على الله ورسوله. What do we mean by this? We mean, first and foremost, we want to talk about manners. Your manners start with Allah. التأدب مع الله أولا. They have your manners with Allah first and foremost. We want to talk about having good character. Have good character with Allah first and foremost. Know the position and authority of Allah and His Messenger before you say and do anything. This is what we mean by يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَمَا أَقْبَحَ الْقَوْلِ مِنْ بَعْضٍ. And how rich is a statement some of them have made. Those of you that come from various Arab countries, you must have heard this. وَجَدْتُ الْإِسْلَامَ فِي الْغَرْبِ وَلَمْ أَجِدِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَتَنْقُصُهُمُ الشَّهَادَةُ فَقَطْ. مَا أَقْبَحَ هَذَا الْكَلَامِ. That I found Islam in the West, but I didn't find the Muslims. All those people need is the shahada. وَيْنَ التَّأَدُّبْ مَعَ اللَّهِ. Where is having good attitude with Allah? Those people who deny the favors of Allah upon them, Allah created them, sustained them, provided for them, gives them health and wealth, and they deny Allah. Is this manners with Allah? Is this humanity? And this is why we say, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. This is the first lesson. You want to have manners, you want to talk about humanity, first of all, the one who created you, have some manners with him. Have some manners and know your place when you deal with Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is why as believers, when we say we are Muslim, what does it mean? Al-istislamu lillah. That we surrender and submit ourselves to Allah. وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. That when Allah, that is not befitting for the believing man and the believing woman, when Allah decrees something and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when they declare something, there's no option for them, there's no decision for them to make. Rather, they submit to Allah. And from also this ayah is when people do bid'ah, Allah says, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم. I've completed and perfected your religion for you today, yet you think it's incomplete. You want to precede Allah and His Messenger in something that they did not stipulate. This is what we mean, that know your place and know that you as a Muslim, you submit your will, you submit your desires, you submit your opinions and everything to Allah. How many times now do we find today when something happens around in the world, a news incident happens, some kind of incident takes place in the world and people rush to have a stance. I'm talking about the Muslims. They rush to make a comment or an opinion on what happened, but they don't go back to what Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam say. They don't want to know the stance of Islam first. They want to rush to make a comment based on their views. So this is the first lesson that we can learn from here. The second lesson, Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِن جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَئٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا. That, oh, you who believe, if a fasiq, if an evildoer, somebody who is wretched, somebody who is munharif, somebody who has gone, is deviated in his religion and his manners, in his akhlaq, when he comes to you with news, فَتَبَيَّنُوا, then verify that news. Allah does not say, accept it straight away, and neither does He say, completely reject it. Allah says rather, فَتَبَيَّنُوا, and in another riwayah, فَتَثَبَّتُوا, that verify that news. Clarify, see if it's true or not. Why? أَن تُصِيبُوا قَوْمًا بِجَهَالَةٍ فَتُصْبِحُوا عَلَى مَا فَعَلْتُمْ نَادِمِينَ. Before you make a judgment on someone else and you wrongly accuse other people based on no evidence. And then after that, what happens? You become regretful of what you've done. You become remorseful over what you have said. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, كَفَى بِالْمَرْءِ كَذِبًا كَفَى بِالْمَرْءِ كَذِبًا أَنْ يُحَدِّثَ بِكُلِّ مَا يَسْمَعُ. It's enough for a man to be a liar, that he just talks about everything that he hears. You hear one thing, you don't even check twice, you go and speak about it. The Prophet ﷺ says, enough for you to be a liar. And what is even worse is when you talk about Allah without any knowledge. As Allah says, وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ افْتَرَىٰ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبِ. And who is more deviated, who is more wretched than the one who he fabricates lies about Allah. And what do we do when we're on WhatsApp and we're on Facebook and we get a post about Islam, about what Allah said and the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, oh, this is what Islam says. We don't want to verify, we don't want to check the source, we want to forward it straight away. And surprisingly, Allah willed for that the hadith that is perhaps the most authentic and most transmitted hadith, massively transmitted, is the hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, من كذب علي متعمدا فليتبوأ مقعده من النار. Whoever intends to lie upon me, then let him make his place in the hellfire. This is how harsh it is, because the deen is preserved and the Prophet ﷺ made sure that nobody dares to make a lie against him, except that he will be in the fire. And then we have people that want to go and cause chaos. People who are anarchists. They like chaos in the land. So when they hear news that frightens people, they want to scaremonger. They want to go and scare people. And Allah says in the Quran, وَإِذَا جَاءَهُمْ أَمْرٌ مِّنَ الْأَمْنِ أَوِ الْخَوْفِ أَذَاعُوا بِهِ. That when a matter of fear and security comes, when news about something comes that is going to affect the security of the people, the peace of the people, أَذَاعُوا بِهِ. You go and you publicize it. You go and you spread it quickly. You want to be the first one to spread the news.
وَلَوْ رَدُّوهُ إِلَى الرَّسُولِ وَإِلَى أُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْهُمْ لَعَلِمَهُ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَنْبِطُونَهُ مِنْهُمْ.
If only they went to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he was alive, and to those who are in authority, those who can make sound judgment, those who are the specialists in the field, if they only went to them first, then they would be able to validate the claim for them. They would be able to authenticate what has been said to them. So here the point is that if news comes to you, you don't wrongly accuse people. You don't wrongly go and make judgments on people without thinking about, without checking the evidence. And how many times today are people being wrongly accused? We're seeing it today. People wrongly accused who are innocent. And the media will rush to defame them. The media will rush to ridicule them and mock them. And in the end, they find out, you spread it around, and then you find out that that person was innocent. And you've done dhulm on that person. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that the people, لو يعطى الناس بدعواهم, if people were given it according to their claims, when it comes to disputes, if people are given according to their claims, لدعى ناس دماء رجال وأموالهم, then people would claim the lives of men and would claim their money. ولكن البينة على المدعي, but the burden of proof, the burden of evidence is upon the one who's making the claim. You want to claim something, you want to say something, you bring your evidence. قل هاتوا برهانكم إن كنتم صادقين. Bring your evidence if you're truthful. This is what our deen talks about. We don't do things on hearsay. We don't do things on doubts and how we feel. So this is another lesson of humanity that Allah teaches us in the Quran. Moving on, Allah then talks about disputes. Something that is highly valued in our sharia when you reconcile between people. And Allah says, وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اقْتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. When two groups of believers are fighting and disputing with each other, what should you do? Should you lure them on? Tell this guy what's happening here and start getting them to fight even more? وَفَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. Reconcile between them. Be sincere towards them. You want the best for both of them. فَإِنْ بَغَتْ إِحْدَاهُمَا عَلَى الْأُخْرَى فَقَاتِلُوا الَّتِي تَبْغِي حَتَّى تَفِيئَ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. How beautiful is this religion? That if one of the groups transgresses, even after you try to reconcile, they want to fight, they want to be violent, and they want to attack the others, and they want to take the lives of the others, then you fight them. Why? To stop them from their aggression, to stop them from their oppression on the other believers. But look at this. Even after you stop them now from their oppression, Allah says, فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا بِالْعَدْلِ وَأَقْسِطُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ. Look at this. Allah doesn't say, fight them until they stop the oppression. No. Reconcile once again. Reconcile once again, but this time Allah says, بِالْعَدْلِ, with justice. Why? Because if they hurt the others, if they took the rights away from those people, make sure those rights are returned back. Make sure that justice is taken place so that neither group has any harboring of hatred towards each other. And Allah loves those who are just. And then Allah finishes off with an amazing ayah that wallahi al-azim, it represents what we see in the masjid today. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةً. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةً. Verily the believers, they are like brothers to each other. They are brothers to each other. فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَ أَخَوَيْكُمْ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. So reconcile between your brothers. If you and your family, your brothers have disputes, do you let that go on? Or do you try your best to resolve it? And this is what Allah is saying, to resolve the matter. And there is no ukhuwah, there is no brotherhood that is more stronger than the brotherhood of iman. You know, they say blood is thicker than water. We say, yes, blood is thicker than water, no doubt. But iman is thicker than blood. Iman is thicker than blood. Anything that you think of that unites the people, it doesn't unite them as much as iman. And Allah says in the Quran, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا. That all of you hold on together onto the rope of Allah, وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا, and do not disunite. وَاذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ إِذْ كُنْتُمْ أَعْدَاءً فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَتِهِ إِخْوَانًا. That remember the ni'mah of Allah, remember the blessing of Allah, that when you were fighting amongst each other, when you had your differences, that Allah united your hearts and you became what? Ikhwana. You became brothers. When you enter into this religion of Islam, you become our brother. Regardless of what color you are, regardless of what race you are our brother. And this is the beauty of Islam. And Allah says in the Quran, وَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِهِمْ, that He, Allah, what did He do? He unified the hearts of the believers. لَوْ أَنْفَقْتَ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا مَا أَلَّفْتَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِهِمْ. Allah is saying to who? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most noble of all men. He's saying, even you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you were to spend all the money in the world, imagine this, a Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most noble, the most sincere, if he was to spend all the money, for what cause? To unite the people, ما ألفت بين قلوبهم. You wouldn't be able to reunite their hearts. ولكن الله ألف بينهم. But it's Allah who unites them. This is the beauty of al-Iman. This is the beauty of al-Ukhuwa fi al-Islam. This is the beauty that we have in our brotherhood and unity that nobody can touch, even if we are in few in number. And we look towards others, other groups, and we might say, as Allah says, تَحْسَبُهُمْ جَمِيعًا وَقُلُوبُهُمْ شَتَّى. You think that they're united in their causes? They unite for environmental purposes. They unite for their tribe. They unite for their race. They unite for this cause. But قُلُوبُهُمْ شَتَّى. Their hearts are apart. Whereas the believers, المؤمن المسلم للمسلم كالبنيان يشد بعضه بعضا. The Muslim to the other Muslim is like the bricks of a building, that they are together. مثل المسلمين في توادهم وتعاطفهم وتراحمهم كمثل الجسد الواحد. That the likeness of the believers, the likeness of the Muslims in their compassion, in their empathy to each other, in their mercy to each other, is like that of one body. This is the beauty of al-ukhuwa fi al-Islam. And then Allah mentions, going on to the next values, Allah mentions, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا again. لَا يَسْخَرْ قَوْمٌ مِّن قَوْمٍ عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُونُوا خَيْرًا مِّنْهُمْ وَلَا نِسَاءٌ مِّن نِسَاءٍ عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُنَّ خَيْرًا مِّنْهُمْ. That, oh, you who believe, don't let the men or the believing men ridicule other men, because maybe those men that they're ridiculing and taking and abusing, maybe they are better than them. And the women as well. And Allah here mentions specifically the women, that let not women start ridiculing another group of women, lest those women that they are accusing are better than them, because of what happens in the majalis of the women, what happens in the gatherings of the women. But Allah has addressed both here. And then Allah says, وَلَا تَلْمِزُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. SubhanAllah. The wording that Allah uses, وَلَا تَلْمِزُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Don't defame each other. Don't start defaming each other. But Allah says, أَنفُسَكُمْ, yourselves. Allah doesn't say, وَلَا يَلْمِزْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا, which means don't abuse or don't defame each other. Allah says, لَا تَلْمِزُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Don't defame yourselves. Why? Because you are brothers. Allah just told you that you are brothers. So when you defame your brother, you are only defaming yourself. وَلَا تَنَابَزُوا بِالْأَلْقَابِ. And don't go and call each other offensive nicknames. Don't start labeling each other with things that are offensive. This is what we call humanity. This is what we call manners that Allah taught us way before these people came up with all their human rights conventions. And then Allah says, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَتُبْ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. Whoever doesn't repent from this, then they are oppressors. ظَالِمُونَ. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, اتَّقُوا الظُّلْمُ فَإِنَّ الظُّلْمَ ظُلُمَاتٌ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. That beware of oppressing and transgressing people and going beyond the bounds. Why? Because dhulm on Yawm al-Qiyamah is going to be excessive darkness. When the believers have nur, when they have lightness coming, because it's going to be pitch black, they're going to be people who are going to be in even more darkness. Don't be like those people who come on Yawm al-Qiyamah and you have your salah and your zakah and the amount of hajj you did and umrah you did and you gave in this sadaqah and that sadaqah. And then you come and people start taking their rights from you. They take your salah, your zakah, your hajj, all your hard work and hard efforts gone to those people. Why? Because you took away their rights. You abused them. You were bullying them. You were calling them bad names and you were defaming them. Now you take their evil deeds. So this is another lesson. Moving on to the next lesson, Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اِجْتَنِبُوا كَثِيرًا مِّنَ الظَّنِّ إِنَّ بَعْضَ الظَّنِّ إِثْمٍ. That, oh, you who believe, stay away from اجْتَنِبُوا كَثِيرًا مِّنَ الظَّنِّ. Stay away from a lot of suspicion. For most or some of the suspicion is sinful. What do we mean by this? That when you want to start doubting your brother or your sister, and you start thinking about them evil thoughts, negative thoughts, you stay away from this. You got no evidence to say so. Don't start thinking bad about your brother without any evidence of you thinking making that base on there. That you start talking bad about him, or you start mentioning thinking bad about him. Why? Because this is a sinful thing, and it's going to lead you to the next thing. وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا. Don't spy on each other. Because the minute you have bad thoughts, the minute you accept those bad thoughts to enter your mind about your Muslim brother and your Muslim sister, you're going to start spying on them. Like the husband starts checking his wife's phone, or the wife starts checking the husband's phone secretly. This is not allowed in this Islam. Why did he start doing that? Because he's doubtful. Because he's got su'ul-dhan. He's got evil thoughts about them. And what happens then? وَلَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا. And do not backbite with one another. Don't start backbiting. Now if we look at this one, I want to make a very important point here. Because it's been misunderstood among our community, amongst the Muslims today, the modern brand of Muslims. When we say don't have bad thoughts about someone, we're saying if you see a person in a doubtful matter, you know, you see him with another woman or something, and there's nothing haram, but you just look at that and it looks doubtful, don't have doubts there. That's what Allah is warning about. Okay? When you see him with not a good crowd, don't have doubts. You don't know what's happening. You don't know what the circumstances is. But that doesn't mean we start saying, oh, don't judge me. We don't believe in this statement, don't judge me. What did Umar ibn al-Khattab say? What did he say? إِنَّ أُنَاسًا كَانُوا يُؤْخَذُونَ بِالْوَحْيِ فِي عَهْدِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. That people would be judged on by the wahi, by the revelation from Allah in the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Why? Because Allah knows what's in our hearts. If somebody was sincere, Allah would say he's sincere. If somebody was a munafiq who hid kufr in his heart, Allah would expose them and say it. This was wahi. وَإِنَّ الْوَحْيَ قَدْ انْقَطَعْ. But the wahi has stopped now, Umar said, Umar al-Khattab. The wahi has stopped, the revelation has stopped. وَإِنَّمَا نَأْخُذُكُمُ الْآنَ بِمَا ظَهَرَ لَنَا مِنْ أَعْمَالِكُمْ. Now we're going to judge you based on what your apparent actions are. You do haram, you drink alcohol, you smoke drugs, you do zina. We're going to judge you based on your apparent. وَلَيْسَ فِي سَرِيرَتِهِ إِلَيْنَا مِنْ شَيْءٍ. That whatever is in private, فَمَنْ ظَهَرَ لَنَا خَيْرًا فَمَنْ ظَهَرَ لَنَا خَيْرًا. So whoever does good, Umar al-Khattab is saying, whoever does good apparently, أَمِنَّاهُ وَقَرَّبْنَاهُ. Then we trust him and we bring him close to us. This man's doing good. He gives charity. He prays salah. He goes for hajj. He helps the Muslims. We bring him close to us. We believe him. We trust him. وَلَيْسَ فِي سَرِيرَتِهِ إِلَيْنَا مِنْ شَيْءٍ. And whatever he does in private, behind closed doors, between him and Allah, Allah يُحَاسِبُهُمْ فِي سَرِيرَتِهِ. Allah is the one who will hold him accountable. It's not us to hold him accountable to what he does. Whether he's a munafiq or not, it's not upon us. What we judge is which that is apparent. وَمَنْ ظَهَرَ لَنَا وَمَنْ أَظْهَرَ لَنَا سُوءًا. And whoever comes to us and he shows us evil, he's somebody who does drugs, he's somebody who drinks alcohol, he's somebody that does zina and has haram relationships openly in front of the people, then we judge him based on that. We judge him based on that. لَمْ نَأْمَنْهُ وَلَمْ نُصَدِّقْهُ, like Umar ibn al-Khattab said. We're not going to trust him and we're not going to believe what he says. وَإِنْ قَالَ, and listen to this, وَإِنْ قَالَ إِنَّ فِي سَرِيرَتِهِ حَسَنَةٌ. Even if he comes and says, well, you don't know me, don't judge me, I might smoke drugs, I might drink alcohol, I might have a haram relationship, but I get up for tahajjud, you don't know about that, I give sadaqah in private, you don't know about that, we say we don't care about that. That's between you and Allah yawm al-qiyamah. Allah is the one that's going to judge you on that. But what we judge is what's apparent. It's funny because if you find somebody stealing in the bank, is going to be let off because he said, oh, you know, I needed some money. Or I killed someone because I don't like his face. Then we're allowed to judge. Then we're allowed to judge. But what about when it comes to the law of Allah that Allah told us to judge? And so let's stay away from this. Carrying on, Allah says, وَلَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَن يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا فَكَرِهْتُمُوهُ. Don't backbite one another. And what does it mean by backbiting? The Prophet ﷺ, he said, أَتَدْرُونَ مَا الْغِيبَةِ. Do you know what al-ghiba is, backbiting? And the Sahaba, they said, Allah wa Rasuluhu A'lam. Allah and his Messenger ﷺ knows best. And he said, ذِكْرُكَ أَخَاكَ بِمَا يَكْرَهُ. To mention about your brother that which he doesn't want to be mentioned. That's what he doesn't want people to know. And then one of the Sahaba, they said, what about if what I say is in him, it's true about him? I'm not lying about him, it's true. And Nabi ﷺ said, if what you're saying is true about him, then that is ghiba. If you're lying about him, then that's slandering. That's a whole other kettle of fish. But here, you are backbiting him. And Allah makes it known to us how evil and how bad backbiting is. That he said, أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَن يَأْكُلَ اللَّحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا فَكَرِهْتُمُ. I want you to think about this. Imagine eating raw meat. Then imagine eating raw human flesh. Imagine that human flesh is your own brother. Imagine that is your brother who is dead and his flesh is rotting away and you're eating that. How disgusted would you be? This is how Allah wants us to be disgusted from al-ghiba. And which is why the Prophet ﷺ said, مررت بقوم لما عرج بي مررت بقوم. When I was taken up in Mi'raj to the heavens, I passed by a people, كان لهم أظفارهم من نحاس. Their nails were like made out of metal. يخمشون وجوههم وصدورهم. Imagine nails of metal and they're scratching their faces and their bodies. And the Prophet ﷺ said, من هؤلاء يا جبريل? Who are these people, O Jibreel? قال هؤلاء الذين يأكلون لحم الناس ويقعون في أعراضهم. These are the people that backbite. These are the people who eat the flesh of other people. And they talk about their honor and their dignity. And then Allah says, واتقوا الله إن الله تواب الرحيم. That after all of this, fear Allah. And if you are true in your repentance to Allah, then Allah is the one who's going to forgive you and is going to accept your repentance. هذا وصلى وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده. To finish off with the time, we won't go through all the advices in Surah Al-Hujurat, but we want to finish off with two last points. Allah says after this, we notice, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Allah is constantly mentioning those who have iman. Then Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ. All mankind, everyone, believer, non-believer, man, woman, every single person Allah is addressing, every human Allah is addressing them. إنا خلقناكم من ذكر وأنثى وجعلناكم شعوبا وقبائل لتعارفوا إن أكرمكم عند الله أتقاكم. That we have made you from male and female, and we have created from you your people and tribes so that you get to know one another. But the one who is most noble, the one who is most virtuous amongst all of you, is not the one who has a certain color of the skin. Is not the one who has qualifications or a job or a status. Is the one who is akramakum inda Allah atqakum. The one who is most noble in front of Allah is the one that has the most taqwa. The one that has the most taqwa. When we look at all these other things that we mentioned, we can measure them. You know when they say, you come from this tribe, tarji' liman, you go to which qabila? You can be measured. This qabila is better than that qabila. When it comes to skin, you can say, I'm darker and he's lighter. When it comes to the qualifications, you can say he's got a PhD, he's got masters, he's got no degree. But when it comes to taqwa, who can judge other than Allah? فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنِ اتَّقَى. Don't start praising yourselves. Don't start elevating yourselves. Allah is the one who's most knowing of who has the most taqwa. So this is a beautiful yardstick to go by. Because everybody will strive to have taqwa because they want to be the best. But none of us will know who is the best. Except for Allah. التقوى ها هنا. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, taqwa is here in the heart, in, hidden in the chest. Only Allah knows what is there. Only Allah knows what is hidden in the chest. And He is the one that will tell you if you are upon taqwa or not. And this is why the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم, what did he say? لا فضل لعربي على عجمي ولا لعجمي على عربي ولا أبيض على أسود ولا أسود على أبيض إلا بالتقوى. Nobody said this. Nobody from his era said this, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the West, they came up with only a few hundred years ago to come up with this. The Prophet ﷺ said, there's no virtue, there's no elevated status of an Arab over a non-Arab, or of a non-Arab over Arab, over a black man or a white man, or a white man over a black man, except for taqwa. This is what truly gives you the virtue in front of Allah. Nothing else. No disabilities, no gender, no race, nothing. Nothing that we know of in this world except for taqwa. This is what is going to be judged on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And this is why we want to finish off with the last thing Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. What does this mean? That Allah knows and Allah is well aware. So don't worry about anything. Allah knows best what's happening. And He is well aware of what's going to happen. And He's going to do that. So don't you think now. Don't you think now that you can because you pray your salah. Because Allah has given you the ability to give charity, to go give, to do hajj and umrah, and to do all these khair. Don't start thinking that you've got some virtue now. Rather be humbled like the people of Jannah. What did they say when they see Jannah and they see they've been saved from the Nar? What will they say? They'll say that this is all our doing. Rather they say, Alhamdulillah, الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. Alhamdulillah, Allah has guided us to this. Had it not been for Allah's guidance, we would have never been guided. Not because we did this or we did this. No, rather this is from Allah. And this is why at the end of the surah, Allah says, يَمُنُّونَ عَلَيْكَ أَنْ أَسْلَمُوا. That they come to you, Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, and they say, we have some favor over you because we accepted Islam. You think you have favor over Allah because you pray your salah? You think that your worship benefits Allah? Your worship only benefits you. Likewise, you think when you disobey Allah that you harm Allah? Wallahi, your disobedience only affects you. And this is why Allah says, يَمُنُّونَ عَلَيْكَ أَنْ أَسْلَمُوا. That they want to give a favor over you that they accepted Islam. قُلِ اللَّهُ يَمُنُّ عَلَيْكُ قُلْ لَا تَمُنُّ عَلَيَّ إِسْلَامَكُمْ. Tell them, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, don't bring your favors over me with Islam. You have no favor over Islam. بَلِ اللَّهُ يَمُنُّ عَلَيْكُمْ أَنْ هَدَاكُمْ لِلْإِيمَانِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Rather it is Allah. Allah is the one that has favor over you. Because if you're praying salah, say Alhamdulillah, Allah is the one that gave me the ability to pray salah. If you see you in a halal relationship while other friends are doing haram, don't start saying, I'm better than them, I have better virtue. Rather say, Alhamdulillah, Allah saved me from what he afflicted with them. When you are giving in charity and other people are not giving in charity, Alhamdulillah, Allah enabled me to give charity. This is what the believer has. There's no al-man wal-fadlu lillah. All virtue, all favor is only with Allah and not with anybody else. Ala wa sallu wa sallimu ala khayri al-wara kama amarakum bithalika rabbukum jalla wa ala في كتابه قائلا إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والمشركين. اللهم اجمع شملنا ووحد كلمتنا على لا إله إلا الله. اللهم ألف بين قلوبنا. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. وقوموا إلى صلاتكم يرحمكم الله. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. إنما المؤمنون إخوة فأصلحوا بين أخويكم واتقوا الله لعلكم ترحمون. يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا يسخر قوم من قوم عسى أن يكونوا خيرا منهم ولا نساء من نساء عسى أن يكن خيرا منهم ولا ولا تنابزوا بالألقاب بئس الاسم الفسوق بعد الإيمان ومن لم يتب فأولئك هم الظالمون. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اجتنبوا كثيرا من الظن بعض الظن إثم ولا تجسسوا ولا يغتب بعضكم بعضا
أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا فَكَرِهْتُمُوهُ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَوَّابٌ رَحِيمٌ.
الله سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. يا أيها الناس إنا خلقناكم من ذكر وأنثى وجعلناكم شعوبا وقبائل لتعارفوا إن أكرمكم عند الله أتقاكم إن أكرمكم عند الله أتقاكم إن الله عليم خبير.
الله سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. استغفر الله استغفر الله استغفر الله.